Welcome to the Kendo UI R3 webinar. Hello,
Yeah, welcome
everyone, as you're
everybody. Hi,
joining
hi,
the chat. It's good to see you.
So I'm going to go through a couple of slides here in the beginning and just to make sure that we're all kind of caught up and on the same page. But welcome everybody to the R3 2022 release webinar for Kendo UI. My name is Carl Bergenham, and I'm joined by Catherine and Alyssa, and we're going to take you through everything that's new in Kendo UI. So it's quite a lot to cover today. And now everything that we're covering is available on the Kendo UI What's New website. So you can feel free to go ahead and just either Google search Kendo UI What's New or follow some of the links that we have online through our navigation to be able to find all the new updates. Additionally, and I know this is going to be one of the first questions that pop up, we are recording this webinar. So you can head over to our YouTube channel under Kendo UI TV, or you can just search Kendo UI while you're on YouTube and you'll be able to find the recording there. And for anybody that says, oh, I was going to ask that question, but where can I ask other questions? And the GoToWebinar interface, which will probably be on the right-hand side of your screen, you see this little chat box. Where you can go ahead and type in some questions. Now, those will be answered either by us on the stream if we have some time, but we also have a ton of helpful people behind the scenes that will go ahead and answer your question for you. So if you have any questions about any of our products or anything that we're covering today, feel free to use that chat interface and you'll definitely be able to get an answer as we go through here. As I mentioned, this is the link that you can go to find the recording, and we'll of course follow up with some more information about where you can find all the links later as well. Now, during this, as I mentioned, we do have the chat in the bottom right-hand corner, but we'll also be paying attention to Twitter under the hashtag #HeyKendoUI. So, if you have any questions, then you prefer to use Twitter rather than use the GoToWebinar chat, you can feel free to do so. A shout out that I also want to do is to our excellent DevRel team for the work they do on Code It Live. So this is a Twitch stream that we cover everything related to web development, desktop development, cross-platform development, and re mean really anything that our DevRels are interested in, we'll be able to do a stream on. So definitely continue to check us out on Twitch TV. Some of you might already be doing that, but if you haven't yet, definitely check out Code It Live. We have a ton of different streams happening every day of the week. And now to talk a little bit about what we're doing here today, let's take just a quick look at all the highlights that we have available across all the different flavors. And you can see here, R3 2022 is jam-packed with features across Angular, React, jQuery, and Vue. Now, the big thing that you'll see that's kind of across all of them is that we do have a brand new theme happening this week, Fluent theme. So for all of you interested in Fluent, let's get excited. Alyssa already is excited. I love it. And then we have a ton of new components, a lot of new features, really across all the different libraries that we support. So instead of me spending all this time jumping through each individual one, that's what we have all these sections for and all these folks that are helping us out today. So just to give everybody a rough idea of the timeline, we'll start off with Kendo UI for Angular. We have a little bit of the housekeeping stuff that I'm going through right now, but in a couple of minutes, we'll start with Angular, then we'll jump into React, and then we'll wrap things up with Kendo UI for jQuery and Kendo UI for Vue. But this gives you a kind of a rough time estimate as well. And this is all in Eastern. I am biased because I am located in the Eastern time zone. So if anybody is located elsewhere in the world, feel free to adjust depending on which time zone that you're in currently. But before we go ahead and jump into this, we do have a quick poll question that we're just gonna ask kind of right here as we kick things off. So you'll see this that pop up, and the poll is, are you using or planning to use the Progress Theme Builder? This is something that both Alyssa and Catherine actually will cover in the Angular and React portions, and I'll cover a little bit in the Vue section as well. But we do have a new version of the Theme Builder out, and we're very excited to share that with everybody. So this is just kind of a quick poll to get an understanding of, are you currently using it? Have you seen the Theme Builder at all? Or and what do you think about the new Theme Builder potentially? So we'll see here that actually it's a pretty even split almost between I'm using it, I have plans to use it, and some of you have never heard it of it, which this is great. We'll have a fun opportunity to be able to introduce the theme builder for the first time in a new and flashy version nonetheless, which is great.
You know, I love watching the numbers tick in on the polls.
Yeah, we're seeing it behind the scenes. So we have a little special interest, but it is fun to see the percentages change. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so we'll see that pop up here. So now actually things changed a little bit where we either have plans to use it in a future project or you haven't heard of it being the two biggest chunks. And for those of you that haven't heard of it yet, good news, you'll be able to see some of that today. So that's perfect. Let me go ahead and go back to my slide deck here. So as I promised, we are going to kick things off with Angular. So Alyssa, I'll hand things off to you and I'll let you go ahead and grab presenter just so I don't mess it up for you.
Like I know how to do buttons. I am button clicker person. Yes. Okay. Show my screen and do it. I think you're seeing my screen. I think it's beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It's fantastic.
Excellent. All right. I'm going to collapse the little side panel so I can see the whole thing, but please let me know if anyone has like really juicy questions. Catherine, I want to ask you, I know you're covering a little bit of theme builder. Is it okay if I just do like a general overview and you cover a little bit more? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, absolutely.
On...
Give them a little intro. Yeah, I've got a little bit of a demo that I've got prepared. So I'm going to watch
perfect.
It through.
Okay.
All that. But yeah, get excited.
I'm going to just cover some basics then when we get to it, and then I'll let you handle the more finer details, because that's definitely proper English. Welcome to the Angular section. Let's dig right in. So yes, as I'm much more of a, I don't know, Carl gave us the cool time chunks, which I love, but also here's like, you know, we've got 40 minutes and he did a beautiful intro. I'm going to dive right in. I always love to cover updating the version because sometimes you're like, how do I get the goods? So I think this is a really good screenshot to take to get the most recent version of Kendo UI for Angular components. You can check if there's updates, and then down here you can update all progress packages using that filter, or you can just do Kendo UI for Angular packages, and then a successful run will record the updated versions in package JSON. So check out your package JSON after you've attempted to update, because sometimes I try to update and I'm like, yeah, I'm on the latest version. And then I'll try to use something and it'll be like, I don't know about that component. And I'm like, whoa. So just check your package JSON, make sure things actually, you know, NPM, right? NPM. So I wanted to ask the chat, this isn't an official poll question, but did any of you come by our live stream last week? We were actually, it was a really unique one in person in Boston for our release live stream. We were actually like there when the release happened. It was it was a magical moment. There was lots of cheering. So I would love to know in chat if you were actually there with us, because it was a really, really cool time. I think DevReach, we're definitely planning on doing some more live streaming to Code It Live, and to let us know if you were there to check it out. Carl always writes, I mean, absolute magnificent write-ups for these, not only with Angular, but with all of the components you're going to see today. And we actually don't have time to dive into all of the new features that were even layered onto existing components. And so highly recommend you can take a snap of that QR code real quick or type out this bit.ly. You can so either follow along or afterwards, if you're like, what was that component? What was that feature? How do I find those docs? Because not only does Carl list them out as far as like what is new, but he like links to our actual documentation or live demos of those things. So for sure, this one is a good as a keeper. But these are our new components and our new features on existing components that we're going to be covering today. And we'll dive right into the new components first. So Pivot Grid was introduced in beta last release. And of course, for those of you who don't know, this is a little snap of what a pivot grid looks like, and it is now out of beta. Yay! We're in RTM for the pivot grid, and it features automatic data binding directives for local or OLAP data. And I don't know if you're supposed to say OLAP. I could say OLAP, but I call it OLAP. It's fine.
I know OLAP, OLAP as well, and nobody's corrected me so far.
Yeah. I'm getting away with this. So,
but I guess this is a big SQL versus SQL debate as well. I don't know. If know what
yeah. Right. Yeah, there are some acronyms too that like people look at me and they're like, did you just say WASM? I'm like, what do you say? WASM? Is that really what you walk around saying with your mouth? So
I had that same conversation with someone about the WCAG WCAG.
Yes. Absolutely. I feel like not. If you can pronounce it, you don't think so, Catherine?
I can't say WCAG.
Yeah, WCAG to me sounds like I'm whipping something. WCAG. So I can't in all seriousness say that.
Oh, when no,
I feel like it's all or nothing, right? Like you can't just walk around saying OLAP, but then WCAG, right? Like I feel like there's this like the vision in yourself.
You can rift, get right? across the board.
Yeah. And so if you're interested in the Pivot Grid, that again was in beta last release, but is now RTM. Check out /components/pivot grid. That's where she lives in the docs. And we've got some new features since that beta to RTM transition, a configurator area, filtering, sorting, localization, keyboard navigation, and accessibility compliance. So these are some of these things, especially you'll see time and time again if you've been with us for a while. We like to get our components out as soon as we can, but we have this very high standard for where our components need to be, especially when it comes to accessibility. And so we cannot take off that beta flag until we've met some of those. But she is out, she is shiny. She is ready for fun. Bit.ly, for those of you who prefer that, or QR code, if the typing is just too much. So the next one is the drag and drop component, which I'm so excited about. She lives under component/utils. And yes, I did put a little drag in there because it's like drag and drop. I think somebody at the release party made that joke. And I was like, dragon, get it. But this is a really freaking cool component. It not only allows you to take any Kendo UI, like for Angular component, and make it a drag and drop, but like any HTML element, right? Like I was, Catherine, were you like making fun of me for this one? I think you were. Yes. Yes, I think it was Catherine.
Teasing because we had it in React a couple of releases ago. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes. Yes, that's exactly what I'm talking about.
Yes.
You're like, because React is so far ahead of the Angular
so
components.
Much better. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Keep not. Talking. Okay.
Just to but be no, clear, as this... much as I'm joking about that. Yeah, like we won't always have exact parity because we build natively. So there's always going to be a little bit of discrepancy. Usually Angular gets things first, which is why I was so giddy.
Do we really? I always have the same feeling for React. I'm like, man, somebody really loves React because they always get the cool stuff first.
Carl? See, what you have to think about is that the Angular library has been out for, I think, 2 years longer than the React one. So
it
they all evolve naturally depending on feedback from customers. So it might seem like sometimes one library gets a cool thing that the other one doesn't get. But, you know, it's... in reality, there's a lot of catch up, and then it's all unique depending on our customers.
You know what?
For each
you
library.
Know what I'm hearing, Carl? I'm hearing I love React more, Alyssa. Get over it. That's what I'm hearing. But it's fine. It's still.
I love all my children equally, and I'm just excited about all the flavors.
One of these days, we're gonna get him to admit that he really just wants to go back to jQuery.
Everyone just do jQuery.
Yeah, this should be. Oh, my husband still does though. I mean, we have jQuery components and my husband will still like, I'll be like, oh, we need to make this happen on this website real quick. And he'll just whip out some jQuery. So I'm like, man, whatever works, whatever framework works for you. Oh, I wanted to mention these cool. So I don't know if this, I assume these features are the same across like the React drag and drop and the Angular drag and drop, but we've got these cool different events that are exposed, which makes sense because if you're going to make any HTML element drag and droppable, you have to be able to define the drag target and the drop target, right? But there's other things like auto scroll, which I think I actually have a GIF coming up about that's going to, I think is, Carl's gonna have to correct me if I'm totally lying to you, but I think that's by default on, so that when you like drag a component, it's going to scroll the like container to, so that the nearest draggable droppable element is there. And I will show you this real quick because I'm like butchering this. I'm going to go forward in time so that we can get that little, there she is, and we'll go back because I wanted to show this of like see how the container is scrolling when we drag her boop to the next droppable element. This is like the worst explanation ever. Help me.
No, I think you did a great job.
Help
you know,
me, Carl,
some,
help me.
There are some scenarios that probably call for the fact that you don't want the parent element or the container element to be scrolled through, right? You just want the elements to remain in place. Mm-hmm. But then in some scenarios, like this one, which probably makes a lot of sense as well, for the, especially if you have like a large list, or instead of drop here, pretend these are cards and you're reorganizing them, then it makes a lot of sense to scroll through a large list. So it really just is that difference in terms of the user experience that you're trying to create. But having that behind a flag or a quick property, you can set true or false, definitely makes it easy to implement your requirements.
And so that was the, I'm going to go back through this list. We talked about drag, we talked about drop for the targets that you're defining. Auto scroll is on by default. You can disable it if it's not something that you need in that particular case. Drag hint, render a copy of the original element to be used as a hint during dragging. Drag handle, allow dragging with a specified drag handle. All of this is in our docs and probably more professional wording, because I was like, need shorter words, less words, please. So this is Alyssa's, you know, TLDR version of these. So if you're like, I don't understand what a drag handle is, why are there dot, dot, dots? And Catherine, I think it was Catherine too, she was like, are you trying to say ellipsis? I'm like, no, I'm trying to say dot, dot, dot. Like, I'm pretty sure that's what everyone.
That's the name.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hold to drag. Enable dragging after holding. And axis lock. Enable dragging only after a single axis. Minimum distance. Start the drag only after predefined distance. So I love that all of these are exposed to essentially allow you to build out the drag and drop needs for whatever component or components you are trying. But yes, that is drag and drop. We have it. We are cool. Drag and drop. Oh, I love it. The next cool one, new component that I want to highlight and talk about is signature. And she's actually under inputs. Did talk to her. She does identify as a she, just so you all know. I'm joking. Sometimes I like to assign things. People are like, why is your hairdryer a he? I'm like, ask the hairdryer, right? It's not my fault. So slash component slash input slash signature is where you can find a signature component. And I actually did a little GIF of me absolutely butchering my initials. I can't sign. It's not that I was trying with a mouse. It's just literally like, this is what happens with a pen too. And every time I like, look, someone asks for my signature, I look at it, I'm like, that's what they're getting. Like, are you proud of your signature, Catherine? Are you like, ship it? Like, is that?
I mean, I don't know if pride is a word. I don't think I've ever looked at it and been like, frame it, you know? But I feel like I've had effectively a lifetime to work on it. So I feel like I'm in a good place. It did throw me off when I got married. I had to like, I still feel a little bit like the Nans is tacked on. Like I've got this very complete signature unfair. And then there's another word after it.
Yes.
I've been married for like 6 years. But I'm not any better at it.
You have to think the flow. Yeah. So I think this is real cool because it's the most special. It does. If you are someone who's had to change your name, you know, it's definitely unfair because everyone else has their whole life of like perfecting this signature. So, but yes, this input's really cool. Create handwritten signatures that you can submit as part of a form. And I think, yes, I included the links. You'll see some of them as I zoom in on certain features of a component, they change. That's because I'm trying to help you identify at where in the docs these, further details can be found, but you can also customize the appearance. So I made a little giflet here of me customizing the appearance of the signature input while I'm going to talk about some of the other details. So you can see me, I don't know, like just butcher the looks of the input. You're welcome. But you can, all Kendo UI inputs actually have this ability to customize the appearance. And they've got little settings for that. Line smoothing, definitely needed for Alyssa's signature, but it's just essentially smoothing out the pixels so that it's a better appearance. Value binding, signature supports two-way binding to images, form support for both template driven and reactive forms in Angular, of course. Can you imagine Carl just be like, we only support template driven forms? The riot that would.
Yeah, we take that a hard stance that there's only one true way to write forms. Yeah.
I feel like we kind of should just like on April 1st, just be like, we're actually removing all of our reactive form supports. Just see what people say. Sorry, not. We shouldn't troll people. That's mean. You can also disable the signature as with all of our inputs and have a read only signature as well.
Hold on, by the way, I do think that a poll accidentally appeared. Yes. Oh, there we go. We're back.
Okay.
Perfect.
Oh, no. What did I do?
You did nothing. You did nothing. And we are back. Temporary glitch. Oh, let's move on.
Although, actually, while we've got a moment, there were a few questions in chat that I wanted to raise to your awareness. First off, of course, are you sharing this PDF? Where can people find it if they want to look through it later?
Do we have a way of sharing out easily? I'm sure Cindy's like, of course we have a way. Like email
chat.
Do we have emails?
Yeah, so we can, we'll definitely, we can put in chat, and then also as a part of the description of the video, we can also include it there to make sure people have links.
Okay, cool. I will make sure I have like a minified export of it so I can plop in. Can we plop files? Oh, I can just plop a URL to it. I'm having a really hard time this morning. Okay, so this... I will get you all a PDF. It will be magical and you will not wonder. So it is fine. Yes, that will happen.
Cindy Edward, says, we can share files. So we will make that happen.
Oh, cool. Okay. I'm like, do we even have the technology for this? Right? It's rough. It's been a morning.
Yes.
So yes, really cool. Check out under inputs, the signature. And then I think... let's see what's next. Ooh, the circular progress bar. Another new component in Kendo Angular. It displays and tracks. I'm going to get to that. There she is. The progress with a beautiful arc form. She's glorious. I love her. There are, of course, multiple things that you can control. The center template enables you to like customize what's in the middle of your arc. Color ranges to define essentially matching up this color with this value, that sort of thing. Because, you know, this is great for, you know, red to green. That makes sense. But maybe you've got a pony app and you need to go from pink to purple, right? So animation to enable or disable, which I have like really gotten on this kick of like, what is the setting called, Catherine, where people can essentially, is reduce motion, where people will like set on their system prefers preferences reduce motion. Yes, prefers reduce motion. And then we can be like, hey, you prefer reduce motion, hush animations, right? Like, I think it's just I'm probably like 2 years too late on that train, but I'm getting excited about it.
No, it's great. So I think it's a really like considerate way to create a UI. Like,
yeah, I have actually, you can't tell because we're in keynote mode right now, but when I do live demos with coding, when I was hunting for the reduced motion setting, I found an increased contrast one. And so it makes everything like harsher and there's like all these added outlines, but it's really helped me personally a lot with my, you know, low eyesight issues. So I don't know. I highly recommend if you all haven't checked out your settings, there's a lot that can be done these days that supports accessibility. But I think that's something that's really cool that our components support, just simple and easy, you know, API endpoints so that you can disable that if they prefer reduced motion, or maybe it's a specific use case in the app. Appearance, set the dimensions, width, height, as well as the color, of course. So yeah, those were our four, I think there's four, can I count? New components that were dropped. What time is it? We've got some time. We're doing okay. I might end a little early, depending on how long my demo goes, but we're going to now dive what I categorized as features, because there's some things like the fluent theme that I'm like, that's a feature, right? Or maybe it's a component. I don't know. It's very confusing. Definitions are hard. But we're going to walk through some of these. But as I mentioned before, and maybe I'll show that bit.ly link again. There were quite a few features and enhancements that just did not make the cut on my personal slide deck, but Carl goes through them in detail in the blog. So this one is the next one that I'm super pumped about. Catherine and I are going to tag team this one. But the theme builder, we actually, I'm confused that it's not like theme builder pro, but I think that's like, I'm definitely going to have Carl's help on this one, because we're going to just open it up and we can go there together. You can join or you can just watch me, but we're going to go to themebuilder.telerik.com and I'm going to pull up my Chrome and you will see my messy everything. That was the article that I'm talking about. It's a really good article. You should definitely That's me. Done talking about the article now. Every time Carl writes something, I'm like, let us read. He's such a good author.
Thank you. Now I know where my one view comes from on every post I have. I appreciate it.
Oh, Don't be silly. You know, both of us have to read it for the webinar. You've got at least two. Okay,
Doubling.
Don't be silly. Don't be silly. Okay, so this is us logging into Theme Builder. Let me show you. So I've got this is all new. This is exciting. I'm gonna let Catherine explain what's happening here, and I'm just gonna go Ooh. For it. Just going for it. Catherine's gonna explain. Yeah, there she is.
So as you can
I want you all to know, I took great care to not skip this tour. I wanted to look at it, but I wanted the tour to pop up for the live stream. So do you want to know what I did, Catherine? Because I needed to play with it beforehand. Please. I opened up DevTools and I deleted the tour out of the DOM, and then I could use it. And then when you refresh, the tour is still there because it didn't cache. She's done the tour, right? I'm That's you're welcome, incredible. Chat. Have been doing. All right, yes, but Catherine, tell us what I'm seeing here. This is essentially walking us through the new pieces, all the pieces. We've got four steps.
Yeah. So there's a lot that is new, right? So those of you that might have used the Theme Builder before, this will look a little bit familiar. We have always had kind of this left-hand bar with the different colors that you could choose. I believe the border radius adjustment has always been there. But in general, the previous Theme Builder was more of a way to quickly skin existing components. So if you had brand colors that you needed to adhere to, you could go in and change the values here, the variables, and you could see that reflected across the components, and you can still do that. And that will always be, I believe, a free feature that's available to you through the Theme Builder. However, we now have a new tier that is available, the Theme Builder Pro. And with that, you gain access to this advanced edit panel, which is incredibly powerful. So as you can see here, the tour is highlighting, there's a live preview panel, and then next to it, an advanced edit panel. Live preview will allow you to click and play and explore all of our components. And I believe you can always access the Theme Builder, just kind of poke around and play with it. It's a great way to get familiar if you're new to the library. However, now, if you could swap us over to that advanced edit panel, Alyssa, that'd be lovely.
I may skip the tour. Yeah, you good?
After
you good
all that work to maintain the tour.
I can't click on anything until we complete the tour.
I think it'll take us.
Will it take us in there? Oh, no, yeah. So it's now going to show the teammates button.
It's going to show about sharing.
And also exporting your custom theme, which is important for actually getting your finished product into your application, right? But yeah, let's go ahead and open up advanced. I'm gonna close this banner. Thank you. oh my gosh.
So yeah, beautiful. Your advanced edit panel is gonna allow you to click on any of our components. And then so if you could click on the button, if you could maybe turn off the hints and then click on the button component, then
we you love you. We love you.
Where you have the ability to kind of work your way down this right-hand panel and fully customize the button, right? And I'll do a little bit more of an in-depth demo.
Yeah.
For those of you that don't know, I'm the Kendo React dev advocate, but also the design dev advocate. So this is a big, exciting day. I'm super hyped on the Theme Builder. But yeah, you can go through and adjust.
I love this. There's so much, and it's a little I don't know, maybe is it overwhelming? I think it can be overwhelming, but at the same time, this really does hold your hand if you need to go ahead and get your brand on top of this, or a custom theme on top of this. Will you and yours show the export too? I think the variables and the things. Awesome, perfect. So this is Theme Builder. Please check it out, themebuilderapp.telerik.com. I think it's the shortest. There might be a shorter way to get to it. Honestly, I think if you just Google Theme Builder, you'll find it. but yes, let me go back to you, beautiful, supported in so many different places. Of course, Angular and React, but all of these other really cool places as well. For those of you who may or may not know, we have products on the .NET side. And I guess I have no idea. We have UI for PHP. Since when? Since when, Carl?
Oh, since forever. UI for PHP and UI for JSP have been around almost as long as UI for ASP.NET MVC.
That is so cool.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So theme builders, very, very new features. Very, very amazing. Catherine will be walking us through a little bit more of that. I think, that was a very, I wanted to show the Fluent theme. I ended up just taking a bunch of screenshots of random components, random Angular components in the Fluent theme. Because I was like, well, I just want to show it off real quick. Have either of you used, like, because personally, I was like, Fluent is a thing. So I feel really, had you used it before? I whenever they
I
told us
it was new. I have not used it personally, but I am familiar with it.
Okay. So. Yes.
Yeah, so especially big for folks that are looking to integrate into anything related to Microsoft. So Office 365 is all done through Fluent. SharePoint has a
lot where
of
it is from.
Fluent design. Yeah, so it's Microsoft's design language, just like Material Design is Google's design language. And while it's been called many things in the past, Metro and all the other things
Metro.
Is currently Fluent Design. And that actually spans desktop and web. And even into mobile. So it's a pretty powerful design language.
Thank Carl. I was like, where did this come from? Okay, this is so cool. It's bringing all the worlds together. And it makes me so happy that we have this and support this. For those of you who don't know, I do have a slide at the end that talks about it. But I do a show called JavaScript Girl in a .NET World. Have been learning .NET, loving Maui right now. And so this brings together those worlds of, you know, like, I love that we offer this. And it's, is it, like in all of our libraries right now, Carl, or are we waiting on a few? Are we good?
So the Fluent theme everywhere? Is available in all of the web-based products. Yeah, all the JavaScript ones, and then also UI for Blazor, MVC, Core, PHP, and JSP. So
Blazor, get some. Yeah. Sorry, I shouldn't randomly chant for other frameworks. That was weird. It's totally fine. moving smoothly past that weirdness, we have quite a few updates on existing components. So the way I'm going to do it this time, you all can give me feedback if you think it was like 10 out of 10 or, you know, would not do again. But I'm going to highlight the item itself up top with the URL of where you can find this specific feature, and then we'll just kind of move through different features. And so separate navigable sections were added for the grid, and you can actually see here, I plopped a bit from, we have a demo in the docs that I linked to, but essentially you're passing an array of one or multiple navigable sections to the grid. And so here I think, yes, there is the little, you know, us passing. It's very exciting. And then I actually have a GIF. I'm gonna pull it up. What we're doing right now is waiting on the GIF. There we go. And I'm actually tabbing through, and now I'm arrowing through. And so I really need, like, I think Catherine or maybe it was Carl has a way of capturing like keycast or something, like, because you're like, what are you doing right now with this GIF? But yes, I was tabbing through. And then once I hit that navigable section, I'm like arrowing through. Carl, is there any other bits? Because whenever I first was reading through the docs, I was like, wait, I'm confused. And then I like actually looked at the live demo and I was like, oh, I think I understand. So did I miss any pieces to these separate navigable sections? Like, did I explain it well? Because
you explained it very well. Yeah, the only thing about this, you know, is rather than we have a same default, of course, but there are some scenarios that call for when we do keyboard navigation, that certain elements should be the ones to be navigated through. It all depends on your accessibility requirements. So this allows you to have more granular control over what you want to navigate to and what your requirements call for. So out of the box, you can, of course, make everything navigable, and then you're stepping through every single element. But if you want to maybe skip through something, or if you want to just focus on, keyboard navigation in the grid is mainly for paging back and forth and navigating with the pager, that's fine as well. Right. So just gives you that level of control.
That's nice, because it definitely is something, I don't know if either of you ever tried, but I've like essentially tried to work without the mouse for a while and turned on different like things to help me. And it can be tricky sometimes to navigate sites intuitively. And so I think like adding this extra point that you can refine it, especially if, because grids can get chunky. Like this is a very much mini happy place grid. I have seen grids that are like, oh dear Lord, we're never going to be able to tab through all of these items. So yes, would recommend smoothing out that flow for your users. This one, let's see, we've got save and restore column state. You're welcome. I hear the people cheering. They're at home or in their offices. Oh, yeah. And they're cheering, Carl.
It's a riot.
I know, you're welcome. Check it out. We, with this release, we actually have added the ability to save and restore your column states in the Angular data grid columns. And to persist, I put the little blurb from our docs, but grab that QR code if you want to read more. But to persist the state, you just have to provide the following information as far as the state, things like was filtering or sorting enabled in the grid in that captured moment in time, the data and the columns. And so, yes, that's, I love it. Super exciting. Let's see, we have, I think, another grid update. Yes. Okay. So that grid link is false. It's a false link. I didn't update. It still says persist state. It's going to get you to the grid though, so you'll be most of the way there. But we've actually added max resizable width. I don't know if you can tell in this GIF I made, but I'm like trying to drag the product name beyond 500 pixels and it's just like, no. And I feel like ID would be like even be a better place for this, because if you have a column that's got very small data field, right? Like we're not going beyond two characters. It should not ever accidentally or maybe intentionally get beyond, I don't know, 100 pixels, right? Like it should stay as its small, tiny self. And so I love that we added this. Carl, did we always have the min one? Because in the docs, it talks about you have a min resizable width and then now we have a max. So did min always exist as a property we could define, or are they both new? Sorry, I'm totally putting you on the spot.
I believe, got him. I believe that we had min resizable width for a while, so this is just addressing the other side. Okay, cool.
Because I was like, wait, we had min before? Like, I'm constantly learning new features about that already exist. I'm like, how long have you been there? No, it's, she's probably been there a while.
Track of. We do have so many features, especially in the grid, that memorizing them all can be tough. And then you have, you know, 100 plus other components you need to memorize, so there's a lot going on.
Yeah, no pressure.
Yeah. I love this. I think we should seriously use it for a lot. I think it's going to help just nudge users to a cleaner, you know, state that they don't get into a mess. But I like it. Max resizable width. I think we have time for a poll, perhaps. Maybe. Do we have an Angular poll or something Angular adjacent? All of JavaScript, really.
What is the primary benefit from using really UI for Angular for you? So the Kendo UI for Angular product. And the answers are adding complex components to my Angular app, so like the grid, which we just covered, scheduler, etc. Standardizing on a single solution for UI components, the available technical support, or the consistent theming and styling out of the box.
Oh, are the numbers rolling in? Are they doing that cool thing?
The numbers are rolling in. They're doing the cool thing. Sorry that you can't see this. It's a thrill ride for the rest of us.
Quiet down, Carl. Maybe it is.
I know it sounds sarcastic, but that's more me trying to hide my excitement.
Your excitement. We know. What were you saying, Catherine?
Oh, I was just saying, right, thus far, heavily favoring the first two options. It's kind of
what were they again?
Hanging around 40% on adding complex components to my Angular application and standardizing on a single solution.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It's funny, Carl, I keep pestering him about this specific thing that I want in our library, and he goes, Alyssa, you're the only one who wants that. You're the only one who likes to write CSS. Stop bothering me. And I'm like, other people write CSS.
Stop bothering me. I haven't said that yet.
I'm totally putting words in his mouth. This is me paraphrasing. But it's so funny to me how few people like to write CSS, Catherine, because I love it.
I know. It always blows my mind. That's my favorite thing to do.
So we can see the results here pop up, by the way.
Oh, what is it? Yeah.
Yeah, sorry. Perfect. I know you can't see, so that's why I just wanted to jump in here. So 38% are adding complex components to their Angular app, so I suspect the grid features were heavily favored there. And then 47% are standardizing on a single solution for UI components. We do have over 100 UI components, so that makes sense. And then the next one would be consistent theming and styling out of the box. The Fluent theme will be great for those 13%. And of course, a shout out to the folks that are picking us up for our support. Our support team is excellent. They're helping us out in today's webinar as well. So really, the amount of love that I have for our support team is endless, and just wanted to shout them out.
10 out of 10. I love that shout out. I was trying to see. I think Cindy had messaged me something about the pivot grid, something I needed to mention, but I can't find it. I am not, I got a new phone. I'm like not signed into all the things. So I'm like, I have no way of finding this.
Say, okay.
Yeah.
Let me pull it up for you.
Find the message. I'll move forward in time. And then we will have said message in a collective brain space of ours.
So what they were asking was for Angular Pivot Grid, if you would mind talking us through showing the new configurator. And I've got that open in the window. If you want me to hop over, I can show my screen. And
that actually
we can take a peek at the
does
docs.
Help us to transition over to the React section as well, since we're coming up on that.
That's true.
I think you want me to go. You mean finish these updates? Are you taking over? Yeah, you got it.
Oh, I was just going to show you the configurator page. Perfect. If you want to talk
show
about
me
this.
The configurator. I want to see. I'm going to like exit out of this view so that I can actually see.
That's and then I'll pass it back over to you and you can wrap things up. Perfect. But I just had the link handy and I figured that might be easier.
Thank y'all.
And also, again, I'm not. Does React have this? This doesn't look familiar
configurator?
To me.
Yes, it's just that it sometimes it's not the thing you look at immediately because it is collapsed by default to save some screen real estate.
Oh.
So if you click, you see where it says change settings on the right hand side there, it's vertical. Ah. Yeah, that's the configurator.
Oh, yeah, we
right
do
there.
Have this. I have a new configurator.
So, for those not familiar with the pivot grid, this is like one of the very important parts of organizing what fields you want to showcase. And you can see your columns and rows, right? And you have those pills, you can reorganize them a little bit. I'm terrible at pivoting data, so I'm not going to be able to give you a really good walkthrough of how to use which one to get what kind of data. But the idea here is that as you're pivoting, Pivot Grid is pretty advanced in terms of how you want to set things up, and this configurator just makes it that much easier for end users to pick and choose from the available data fields what they want to display.
Cool. Yeah, see, so as I'm configurating here, you can see it.
Update. It's a real word, right?
Yeah.
Like, did we make it up? Is this Okay.
Yeah. And you can see from the demo, you can also change the position. So top, bottom, right, or left. We're currently on the right setting.
Oh, like where it exists.
Then, exactly. And then you also have horizontal and vertical settings. So for example, top and bottom, it might make a little more sense of horizontal.
That makes us
right?
demo.
yeah, and then that can, of course, collapse again if you like to. So it's just the configurator is great. And then from a developer perspective, you have that API to be able to just quickly change where it's displayed.
Nice. All right, I'm going to pass it back over to you.
Thank you. All right, are you passing or am I... Do I need to do button pressing?
Please,
I can press
take it by force.
I will forcefully. I am showing my screen.
My hands. Yeah.
All right. We only have a couple more updates and I only have 2 more minutes before I'm passing off. I think React is next, is what we said with our words in our mouths. Yes, we did. Okay. Yep. So let's whiz biz through these guys. We have tree view updates, disable only parent nodes and expand disable nodes. So I'm going to actually show the GIF. Here we go. And then highlight essentially before, if a parent was disabled, you could not access said children. And that at the end is me showing what it was before. But now you have access to children, even if you would like access to the children, you can have access to those. And let's see. Yes, there's two parts to this. Disable only parent nodes, so let parent nodes be disabled without having to disable all the children. And then the other side of it, the ability to expand and collapse nodes that have been disabled. So yes, that is a very lovely tree view update. Next one is editor. I wanted to highlight a couple editor updates. Allow users to set their own font sizes, which is as lovely. I think before we had, it was like a predefined list of font sizes. And so now the user has a little bit more control to have manual input on that, which for someone who is very, very blind and cannot see anything and constantly lives at about 48 pixels, like it's a needed, it's good. It's good. So yes, check that out in component/editor. And then it's underneath the TOC. I think that list was correct, or that update. I'm gonna actually double check all of my links before I share my PDF with you all. The filter had, I think, three different updates I wanted to highlight, and so I put them all on one page. Expression value templates. You can define a custom template for any of the editors within the filter component. Support for declarative initialization. Filter component can be initialized now with this new kendo-filter-field, and each field can actually be customized through this, which I think is really, really cool. And a default filter format, devs can define a template or pass an object representing the desired default format that they would like. So yes, there's links and little quick blurbs. We'll share this out. We had two updates to our VS Code extension, new snippets and new scaffolds. I know, we're really excited that people are downloading and using the extension. So if you have not, VisiCos is not a thing. That was, I think, an autocomplete from VS Code. So whatever VisiCode is, I'll definitely be updated. But check it out if you haven't. It's personally like helped me just because 100 plus components and features can be a lot. It can be a lot. So next thing. Yes. If you, our team really does listen to feedback. So if you have any feedback, please send it our way for any feature requests or component requests. If we, are there components that exist out in the world that we don't have yet? Maybe, potentially, possibly, maybe we'll invent them. so this is for my two streams that I do on the reg, Angular Air and JavaScript Girl in a .NET World. Screenshot that if you want to hang out with me some more. And I think that's all. I think we're ready for the React portion of our afternoon, morning, whatever time of day it is. So yes, presenter swap. I think it's Catherine, right? Yes.
Yeah, it's me. I am taking it over. All right. All right, folks. Thank you for hopping in for React. We have a really nice release, actually. Some exciting stuff, obviously, like we talked about from a design perspective with Fluent and with the theme builder. We also have updates to just a ton of our components. This was a really big release for kind of generally upgrading across the board for kind of React. It's really, really nice. So we're going to talk through all of that, probably pretty quick, because there's a lot of it. So let me have over. I'll skim through these pretty quick because we talked about them already, right? The Fluent design theme. So if you are working within the kind of Microsoft ecosystem or making something to match it, you can now use the Fluent theme and have that done and dusted. The theme builder, which is what I promised we would take a closer look at. So I'm going to actually hop out of here and do a live demo, which is really just tempting the gods for something to go wrong. But we're going to try it anyway.
You did your goat sacrifice this morning, right?
I tried, yeah, right?
I tried. Do the sacrifice or you don't do the sacrifice.
Yeah,
right?
Did I do it correctly? Did I have the right number of candles? Did I sprinkle the right amount?
I love you, Kevin.
Did the best that I could with the resources available to me. So as we took a quick peek earlier, this is the new theme builder. And kind of, I love that we got to see a peek into your like ponified components. Oh.
She needs work, though. There's not enough rainbow yet. I will get the rainbow in there because yours is like, oh my gosh, so professional.
there's just a lot of it, right? So, but I think it's really nice because we got to see kind of how drastically you can overwrite the base styles, right? Like, we have all of our basic themes. You can use those up here in the kind of top corner. So if you want to start with one of the themes, including soon to be the fluent theme, I don't think it's in there quite yet, but it will be very shortly. You can grab one of those, customize all of these, right? What we're seeing here are basically your SAS variables. So these connect one-to-one with the variables that are used in our components. You can go through here, edit them. You can also, as you can see here, connect some to other variables, which is an upgrade that I don't believe was available in our original theme builder, and it's very, very handy. That's so nice.
Do you even know how nice that is? That is so cool.
Right. So yeah, you can type in a hex code here, or you get this list of the variables you have already defined, and you can start to connect them and really create a true integrated design system, which is like fantastic. Our goal here was like, right, so we've got our Figma kits, which are fantastic if you have a designer, you know, and if you're working with the design team, our Figma kits are always what I will recommend to give them that kind of full control over breaking down all of our components, seeing how they're structured, being able to dig in. If you want to do that at the same level and you are not a Figma person, that is what Theme Builder Pro is here for you to do. Gives kind of two paths to accomplish the same very important goal. So peeking over into our advanced edit tab, you can kind of see this breakdown. And if you have ever taken a peek at our Figma kits, they look exactly like this. Like, this is one-to-one. But instead of editing that in a design program, now you can kind of take a step down here, right? And this splits off every kind of subcomponent part of this. So you can focus in on the text and change the size or the background, or you can look at the kind of button shape as a whole, update colors. So, right. And you can see that because it uses this like atomic component structure, any change we make is immediately versioned out. And when we go back, we see that versioned out across the entirety of our component library. So anywhere a button is used, your changes are reflected. It makes it incredibly fast and easy to go through and make adjustments. Mm. And if you ever need to really like drill down and make small changes, all of this stuff is available to you, right? And you can change individual settings. So let's do super round. Let's take those off. I think I had too high to begin with, right? Take my border radius off. I can go back, see how that looks across my entire system. And then maybe I say, you know what, actually, not right. Quick undo, right back to where I started.
It's like an undo button, or did you just like Command Z? What did you do?
No, it's an undo. So when you change it, you get a little, like a circle, right? So here,
reset. Oh, I didn't see that.
Okay. Set your values back.
I need that in like all parts of life, but this is great too. This is.
But I really love how much that enables you to kind of play, right? Play. So much of this is let me make a change. Let me see how that looks. Let me, you know, try something new, and then let me switch over to my live preview and see how that looks when the states are changed. Let me see how that looks on, you know, hover when this is expanded or when I play with the slider. So much of that can be really challenging if you're not a designer, is anticipating the way that those changes will play out across every state of every component in a library with 100 plus components.
Yeah, I think it can be crippling for people too, to like step forward and make a simple change just because of that wave effect. So I love this, and it is all in one place. So you can easily say, yeah, we can add that much margin. Like, we can do that, right? I feel like it's silly.
No, I gotta tell you guys, I love it, right? I am completely head over heels for the theme builder. One of the other things that I think is really cool about it, we talked about it briefly, is this like sharing feature, right? So not only does that mean that I can send something to you and you can see it and you can download it, which is in and of itself handy, but we could be in here at the same time making live edits together. So I could send this to you and together you and I can get on a virtual session and tackle the retheming of all of our components, really work together, enabling that like virtual, just kind of connection and collaboration that has become a necessity now.
Yeah. So, but how, once you've like, you know, collaborated, your team's like, this is good, we need to ship this. What, how painful is it to then integrate that into your app?
Incredibly easy. And I'm glad you asked. You set me up, you pitched it perfect for me to follow through. Because I actually, so you can see I clicked the export button and it is currently exporting. It's told me export it successfully. Over here, I get a zip file and I drag that to my desktop just for ease. And over here, I happen to have a quick app that I have spun up using our Create React app templates. And I threw a couple extra components in here just so that we can see the change, right? Mm-hmm. So this is our default Kendo React theme. When I open my LCARS export, and by the way, I did see someone jokingly asking the question if the LCARS theme was available.
LCARS
is not one of our official themes. I'm just a big old nerd. But
we should have like, right? Couldn't we just like, you know, like publish it, you know, like publish ourselves,
it? Like, I don't
see how many million download it.
From a technical standpoint, yes, but from a trademark standpoint, I don't want to step on the toes.
Saying? You're saying we don't want to stand behind the Elcar's Star Trek theme. Is that what you're saying?
I am saying I have enormous respect for designer Michael Okuda, who created all of those, and I don't want to step on his toes.
Oh, is this like whenever they were like, you can't ship to the App Store because you don't have Hasbro rights? And I was like, oh, wait, with My Little Pony.
It's a Trek thing. Yeah, I don't know.
Okay.
Probably. You'd have to have something that's close enough but far enough away to not really be copyright infringement. And then we'd probably have to call it the Space Explorer theme or something like that. You know,
I'm with you.
Inspired by but not a copy of. Yeah.
And that's you'll notice with mine as kind of a joke.
What was your thing you do?
As kind of a joke, it's actually LCARS with a K for Kendo.
UI. I saw that.
When really, LCARS with
a C. Oh, it's good. It was good. So show in export, what files do we have
indexed? Yes. Okay. So I exported from my zip file. I popped open my SAS, right? And so I've got these three files here. I'm just going to drag them all on over, right? I'm going to go ahead and let it replace my index.
You just kind of plopped them in there.
I sure did. I'm going to let this recompile, and you saw it pop into place. It's literally that easy.
Crazy easy.
You go through that WYSIWYG editor, you make those changes, you plop those files in. I like to use SAS, so that's what I use, but there is also plain CSS, and it just swaps. There you go.
Can you open up one of those files just to show those variables in place and like?
Absolutely.
Here they are.
The big one that you'll notice, right, is our tokens. So that's going to be all those values that you set along. Along this.
I miss Adam. You're still using Adam? Oh, that's cute. Sorry, I just realized.
I know. As I'm going to get on and talk about the VS Code stuff, all the really cool tools that we got for Kendo React.
Carl's like, no IDE shaming. I'm like,
I'm here to keep the peace. That's it. I'm here to make sure we're all friends and family.
I learned on Adam. It's near and dear to my heart. I've used some of the clunky ones.
Honestly, when
I started getting into .NET, like it wasn't an option. Like it just, I had to download not just VS Code. I had to download Visual Studio, like the big mama, right? So when I look back, I see you on Adam. I'm like, oh, I miss that. It's good. It's good feels.
Right. I love Atom. I've messed with some of the bigger IDEs, but the other truth is that I like to do all of my Git stuff directly in the terminal, and I really don't
The terminal
like that.
represent.
I don't like that folded into my code editor. I don't want it in my IDE. So anyway, all your
All the
pulling us
variables as we set
forcefully
them. I
back
know,
on
yes.
topic. All of your tokens that you defined there in that left-hand bar are going to go in your tokens.scss. And then anything that you set in that advanced panel is going to go into this overrides file. So you can kind of see how it splits, right? And these are adjustments that I made mostly in terms of like border radius so that everything has that very rounded LCARS look. All of that goes here. And your index file is really just calling those, right? It's saying That's like, awesome. Grab the tokens, grab the overrides
yeah.
together into one SAS file to create your finished styles. But honestly, makes it so incredibly easy. I was stunned the first time I dragged everything over and it just kind of clicked into place and worked. Like,
that's awesome. Yeah, no, yeah, I love it. So it's whether you're Angular or React, check yep. out the theme builder or in between.
Angular, React, I think all of our web tools right now, right? Oh no, I've got it here, right? Angular, React, Vue, Blazor, other products, jQuery, ASP.NET, coming soon. Very
yeah,
soon.
And just as some clarity there in case anybody's wondering. So we've actually had a theme builder for some time. That's already been available for all the products. But what we're talking about right. today is a brand new edition. So by default, like out of the box, twice as fast, has the ability for you to share, actually log in and have projects be persisted over time. Previously, you had to go in and do the same changes every single time. So you can have like a little scratch pad, you can have the official theme, you know, whatever it might be. And we now have better alignment with the variable usage. And then we have a theme builder pro, which goes into those details that you covered. But jQuery, ASP.NET MVC, and ASP.NET Core will soon get the updated twice as fast and the pro version as well. Just needed some additional tweaks to them, so that will come very soon.
Yeah, no, that is definitely, there's some really cool stuff in this release, and so I hate to play favorites like we were talking about, but I think the theme builder is my favorite.
I don't know, Fluent for me. Oh, now that I know it's like on the Microsoft side, I'm like, I think I've got to like Fluent forevermore, but you know, it's just personal.
But we did in fact have one new component.
You got
one new component and it is also the signature.
Nice.
And I'm going to also kind of speed by this because you demoed it and demoed it really well in yours. And it is effectively the same as the Angular version. So capture, reuse, signatures, it's got the same kind of like pen tool acceptance and smoothing and like very, very handy. Yeah, you're gonna watch me like absolutely race through all of the improvements we got because I should have been like you and smart and filtered them down. I should have played favorites a little more, but I put everything in here.
Oh, right.
So we're gonna talk
it's hard. It's hard.
Everything.
Cause you're going through like, oh, and ooh,
real
fast. Yeah, I love it.
Yeah. And yeah, feel free to shut me down if I'm coming up on my time, but I'm gonna try to keep an eye on it. So support for the latest version of TypeScript. So as always, you can upgrade without concern. Updated design for all of our API docs, which is nice. We've been really working kind of across the board on improving our documentation. That's something that is an ongoing project. We're probably never gonna be done. We're just always gonna be moving our docs up to
that's
the next
not,
level, improving,
that's not
improving, improving.
At all, you know, we're just always working on that.
It's a good
no,
thing.
But you're right.
It's a good thing. Docs are important. We take them real serious. So part of an overhaul to improve our documentation, make it easier to get started and to continue using Kendo React. You will see this kind of stuff probably in the next several releases. We did give Visual Studio productivity tools. I haven't used them because I use Atom.
Don't worry, chat. I'll get her using VS Code. Don't worry. It's only a matter of time. It's coming for her. It's one of those inevitable trains. She's got to get on it. It's fine.
I do think it probably is. But I've got all my themes set up. I've got everything just how I like it in Atom. It's hard to do house.
It is. I was actually going to ask you, I was like, what extension is that with your colors on the sidebar? And then I saw that it was Atom and I was like, wow.
It's okay. So no. It actually, if anyone else was curious, it is the fairy floss theme, and I believe it is in existence for a great many code editors. So I think you could use it.
Oh, in, nice.
So, whew. I think I said virtual studio because I was looking at virtualization mode. Spoiler alert. Oh. Smashed everything together there, improving your scrolling and the user experience of scrolling in a grid when you have a whole bunch of stuff. We also got a pivot grid improvement, export to Excel built in. That's something that we had been asked for. I believe that was a request. So if you ever have any doubts that the feedback that you give us actually reaches us, rest assured, it does. We take it quite seriously, and it affects the roadmap. It determines what we choose. So don't correct me if this wasn't a request, because I just went ahead and talked us all up. So I'm 90% sure.
No, everything related to the pivot grid has been requested, actually, for this release, which is great.
Yeah. So similarly, if you were the one that wanted to export to PDF, good news. We got you. That is now also possible. Some built-in loading indicators. So you can, of course, go in and change the look and feel. That's true for everything across the whole suite of components. We make, I would say, an educated design decision, but you are always free to go in and adjust look and feel to match what you want. So now you get a loading indicator when kind of heavy sorting and filtering is at play. Globalization documentation. So if you are looking to adjust cross-culturally when using the pivot grid, we now have some documentation and some guidance to help you accomplish that. More pivot grid improvements. Chart integration. Make it as easy as possible to connect a pivot grid to a React chart. So you can change the pivot grid and then see those changes automatically updated in a live chart, which is actually very, very cool. So it makes it super, super easy to display some of that data in a more visual and easy to parse way for your users. Because I don't know if you've seen a pivot grid recently. They are dense. There's a lot of content. No, because we just looked at it in the configurator. So if you looked at that while we were looking at the configurator and thought like, whew, couldn't be me, then good news, connecting it to a chart will really help. New subtitle properties on our charts. These are really nice, especially from an accessibility kind of standpoint, being able to label charts and make it clear what is in them. We've got some other label updates that I think are coming as well. Yep, nailed it, knew it was coming. Label supported bullet charts. It really helps to give that contextual information, especially if your users are using a screen reader or something that is not necessarily able to translate a visual in the same way. You can make accessible data visualizations. It is possible. It takes a little work and a little thoughtfulness. And we are here with our components to help you make that as easy as humanly possible. We do have some accessibility news coming up, but I won't. Yes, I was so good at these slides. I love that I made these and then forgot the order that they were in. And I was like, I don't want to give away
time.
The big accessibility news. It was the next slide. very exciting. We are WCAG 2.1 compliant.
WCAG.
No.
She won't do it.
We are WCAG 2.1 compliant. But genuinely, accessibility is one of the things we are most passionate about. We were previously 2.0 compliant, which I'll go ahead and tell you is pretty darn good, but not good enough. So we're continually meeting as the standards are updated, as we get new news about what's better and what's more helpful. There's already 2.2 discussions for the WCAG standards, and we are already working on meeting those. So you can expect every time WCAG makes an update that we will be updating as well to make sure that we match and stay in compliance. Just one more great reason. Oop, I accidentally highlighted stuff on my screen. Yeah, we made so many bug fixes and enhancements that even in Carl's blog, he does not list them out, and Carl lists everything.
Carl, you list everything. Carl, why you know me?
No, so there's just a lot. So, you know, a big focus for this release on the React side was resolving bugs, the quality of life improvements, and features to individual components. So really, while we're highlighting some of the bigger features in here, I don't know, Catherine, if you're going to jump over to our demos, but you see there'll be updated tags everywhere. And if you ever peruse the change log, which some of you might do to see the nitty gritty details.
Hey, don't knock it, Carl. It's going on. Knock it.
No. I'm saying if you are perusing, if you like to understand exactly everything that's changed, if you take a look at between May, which is when we had the R2 release, and now R3, there's a massive amount of changes. It's impossible to highlight everything. There's just a lot happening, but the really good thing about that, right, is for all of our React users is that, you know, this is the most stable release to date, right? We've introduced so many new components.
What you're showing, like, what are you, where is your,
this is the,
where is your browser? What am I looking at? What is happening?
I changed browsers recently. I'm using Arc now.
That's a thing. We support this? Yeah. Okay. All right. I will go look it up.
Well, Arc is Chromium-based. So just to talk about like compatibility, right? Like, yes, we do make sure that all of our components support all of the major browsers. And that includes Chromium browsers, of which Arc is one. I was very hesitant about moving to like a non-standard browser, but I got to tell you, it's won me over.
Everybody frantically Googling Arc.
I know. Yeah. Well, just because our docs look so good in it. And I'm like, what is this witchcraft?
That's just how good our docs look.
I mean, they take it an update.
You were asking me about the change log, right? And like, you can see a whole bunch of this kind of stuff. So if you really do that nitty gritty, then you can see every single thing that we adjust is listed out in our changelog, and it's fun. You know, if you're looking for a little like bedtime reading,
rude.
Check it out.
Some joking. People do it in the middle of the day, darling. Bedtime.
Oh, you don't ever, you settle in with, you know, a cup of hot tea, and you're like, Pride and Prejudice, not tonight. Kendo React changelogs.
Changelogs. They just like change logs in general, right? And I know we're all making fun, but I know we've also all been there. So that's all
I will go. I do check the change logs, actually. I like to see when the last thing was pushed and if I need to update anything. Yeah. So from a very practical standpoint, yes. A little bit of a joke, but the change logs are useful, and I would not have pulled them up to show to you if I did not believe that they were. I made it through the marathon. So some other folks have called out our Code It Live channel, and I want to as well. I always forget to do this, and today I remembered. Mm-hmm. But we do, we have folks from the DevRel team, I think literally every day of the week on streaming live. So definitely come hang out with us. We talk about all sorts of stuff. We do live coding, we do chit chat, we do design talk, we do Kendo React and Kendo UI. Demos, there's all sorts of stuff that is happening on Code It Live. And I will tell you, it is most
fun. We make lifetime friends, Catherine. We make lifetime friends.
Like, it sounds a little cheesy, but yeah, having met some of them last week at DevReach, yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely, we do.
10 out of 10.
10 out of 10. So yeah, I recommend joining live if you can. That's the best way to make friends. If you can't, then all of them get uploaded afterwards to Kendo UI TV. Where you can watch at your leisure.
Sans friends, so. But just as good, yeah.
Same, you get some friends together, have a watch party.
Oh, watch party. Yeah.
That's a thing people do. That's reading the changelogs. Oh no, typo. Enjoy our R3 announcements. Don't pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. I'm gonna stop showing my screen now. With this giant type.
What do you got?
So Carl? we do have one poll that we also want to run here right before we wrap up on the React side. So it's very similar to the folks that we covered on the Angular side. What is the primary benefit from using Kendo React for you? So adding complex components to my React app, standardizing on a single solution for UI components, the available technical support, or the consistent theming out of the box. So that should be popping up here for everybody. So if you're a React developer and using Kendo React, love to hear from you here. Now, I don't know if people still see our faces, you know, as we're showing the poll, but, you know, I'll provide color commentary in the meantime to just fill the void.
I don't think so. I think all they see is poll. I think it's just poll,
yeah,
really big.
They just hear our voices.
I hope so, frankly.
I'm sitting here. I'm bouncing. I'm enjoying life. But we're seeing here that a very similar breakdown to the what we saw on the Angular side, where we had complex components as well as standardizing, kind of swapping places here between first and second as more and more people are voting. But there are still some people that are doing consistent theming. And on the React side, if you do any sort of Office 365 integration, which a lot of it is written on React, then the Fluent theme is right up your alley.
Should we ask a question? Is this a good appropriate time for this?
Yeah, we can. We can probably see if there's any questions that we can.
You know how we've got developers. Ooh, there's the. So who won? It was the top adding complex components.
Who won?
Yep. Who won? Now we'll separate you in these groups, and you will do battle. So.
You're welcome. Poor consistent theming and styling out of the box group. They're not going to last long.
No, those are the strongest 5%.
Oh, they're the strongest. Right.
Yeah.
No, we have, as you mentioned, and shout out to our support team and our devs behind the scenes who are answering questions right and left. They're amazing. But one of them has a question for the chat, and they wanted to know if anybody, Carl, how do you say it? How do you say Fiori?
So that's more if you happen to be using the Fiori theme, which is for those of you that aren't familiar, if you integrate into SAP, that is the design language used over there. So that's more, you know, just if you are using the Fiori theme, feel free to just say a quick little yes in the chat. You know, that's just for, it's a lot of different design languages out there when you think about it. And sometimes you read a word and you don't know how other people pronounce it. So I'm saying a Fiori without confirmation of anybody anywhere.
Oh, cool.
Saying it's right or wrong.
But no, let us know. Our devs want to know if you're using it. And then I think we're ready for the Carl portion of today's show.
So get ready, everybody, because I'm about to do a lot of talking. And I appreciate everybody listening in. So I'm going to go ahead and grab presenter for myself. I swear I know what I'm doing. There we go.
My husband, I go, can you bring me a cup? And he goes, what for? I said, for water. He goes, but no water, just the cup. And I said, I have 4 gallons under my desk. And he goes, dear Lord, woman.
You're just hiding gallons of water? You're just hoarding
I'm stocked. I'm ready to go. I am hydrated. I can totally attend.
You just got to drink from the bottle. Assert dominance.
That would be a nightmare. The mess.
If it's in a keg, you can do a keg stand of water. But I don't. Yeah,
we totally condone that.
Yeah, exactly. We totally condone that behavior. But let's dive into what is new in Kendo UI for jQuery, everybody. So very exciting news. Just like we talked about in Angular and React, we have the new Fluent theme. So for those of you looking to integrate into the Fluent design system, woohoo! Got Fluent happening in jQuery as well. And then we have a couple of new components. So the split button and the drop-down button, actually, you might not realize that those weren't components that we had available in jQuery until now because they've been kind of hidden in the toolbar component, but we're extracting them just to make sure that you have those as standalone button elements that you can add into any jQuery page and just bring that consistency that you see across all the Kendo UI flavors. We also have the new signature component. And then we have some pivot grid updates, some grid improvements, accessibility compliance, and accessibility demos. I'm really excited to talk about that and more. I'm not going to be able to cover absolutely everything here. And if you see me looking down, I've been paying attention to some of the chat that we have, as well as just making sure I'm checking on time. So I'm not being rude. But the new Fluent theme, right? It follows the Fluent design system that Microsoft has provided us with. And over here, you see a screenshot of the scheduler with the Fluent theme. I try to pick a new component that just makes it a little bit interesting to see some of the elements there. So perfect for anybody looking to integrate with Office 365, or you just prefer to use what's out of the box, kind of as a design language coming from Microsoft. And of course, we have Figma kits available for the Fluent theme as well. And as we mentioned, since we talked about the theme builder and the other products, Fluent theme support in the theme builder will come soon. And then jQuery support in the new theme builder with that additional granular control will also come in the near future. But more on that when that gets released, of course. And now the split button, the name really gives it away. It's a button that is split between two things. You have the left-hand side where it says paste, and on the right-hand side, you have the little drop-down. So a user can either interact with the main button element, so for example, paste, or they can select something from the drop-down and do that action. So it's essentially one main action, which with the ability to provide additional actions in that drop-down. Similarly, the drop-down button, the name gives it away, but instead of having a main action that happens when you click on the button, all the actions are listed in that drop-down. So in this particular example, we have user settings, and when a user clicks that, that drop-down will appear. So really the purpose of these different button elements is just to give you as many of the possible scenarios for buttons that you might have within your application and make them readily available with a specific user experience in mind so that you don't have to have this one mega button that does everything, but then also is a very heavy, you know, element and has a lot of advanced configuration, et cetera. These make it nice and easy to determine what particular type of user experience that you want. Mm. Now, the signature component, as you can see in the screenshot, I stole this from the Angular page just because that's when
much better signature than
mine. Yeah, so that is not mine. That is just somebody that put together a nicer looking signature than I could produce. So I stole that, yeah. And that's why you see Angular, but it is native to jQuery, but it just happens to have the same look and feel as we saw in the other components. And that's one of the benefits that we have with Kendo UI is that, yes, we have different libraries built for different UI libraries built for different libraries and frameworks, but they're all built from the ground up while sharing common rendering. So if you see a signature component in jQuery, you'll see the same looking signature component in Angular, Vue, et cetera, as these components get released. Now the pivot grid, that screenshot is so blurry, but the pivot grid, we have two versions on the jQuery side. And the reason for that, for some historical context, is that we have redesigned the pivot grid and we're calling this pivot grid V2 within jQuery. And then this updated design and updated user experiences was out of the box and default for currently the React and Angular pivot grids. But rather than just remove the old pivot grid across a bunch of breaking changes, we have this new pivot grid that we're adding these features to. And one of the big things we added with this release is local data binding support. So you don't have to have OLAP cube that you bind into, which if you've ever tried to do that yourself, you know that can be a little bit of a pain. So local data binding just allows you to have a JavaScript array that you can handle and deal with that data interaction a little bit easier on your own. On the grid side of things, we have a disabled column menu, which you can actually do on a column by column basis now. So instead of just enabling the column menu, which is what we can see here in the screenshot that appeared when I click on the three dots, you can say, yes, I want column menus, but now you can go in each individual column and determine this should have it or this should not have it. So just a little bit more granular control over when to show or hide the column menu, depending on the data types they have available. Now, another quality of life improvement is the ability to hide the currently grouped column. Now, what you might see here in this screenshot is that we are currently grouping on the discontinued field, but the discontinued field is not displayed within the grid. Previously, before this release, you still actually saw wherever the discontinued field would be in the column collection, you would still see it displayed. And now this is just a flag that you can turn on or off if you just want to hide a column if it's been grouped. So this, you know, for those of you that have been asking for this, it might seem like a very obvious feature. So I'm very happy that we have this available now, just out of the box with the jQuery grid. Now, an additional change, pun fully intended, is that we now fire the onChange event only when a user selects or deselects a row. So for anybody that's subscribed to the onChange event in the grid, it can fire for a lot of different reasons up until R3 2022. So while this, depending on your use case, can potentially be a little bit of a breaking change if you're, you know, hooked into the onChange event for you know some type of behavior that you have today, but really the intention behind this event has been to deal with selecting and deselecting. So this is now kind of an updated change to this event that should hopefully just trigger this event less and have a little bit more focus on what you should do within this event. Now we also have accessibility improvements. So just like Alyssa mentioned, right, we have WCAG 2.1 support and compliance across all of our suites, actually. But while we've had 2.1 standard support in some suites for a little bit longer than others, we've kind of aligned now on that accessibility compliance and standard within all of our suites. So WCAG 2.1. And now to lean into that even a little bit more, something that we're doing on the jQuery side is we're actually releasing a set of accessibility specific demos. So what this is, and I'll cover that when I jump into and show the demos a little bit more, but what this is essentially an area where you or your testers or your accessibility experts within your organization can go ahead and test our components in the best light for accessibility. So these have been isolated from the rest of our demos because our demos.telerik.com/kendouI are not the best for accessibility testing. And it also allows you to not force a developer to spin up a bunch of different versions of our UI components just for accessibility testing. You now have the ability to hand links over to your accessibility experts and allow them to be able to do testing without necessarily having to worry about, you know, is it configured the right way, or you know, what about all this other additional UX around the component? So great to have for anybody looking at accessibility testing. Now, one note that I should also mention that's new for this release, if you're using the CDN, so only if you're using the CDN, is that just like with the NPM-based packages, if you're using a CDN as of R3 2022, you will have to provide a license key. And that's just because the CDN is freely available, and this just gives us a way to ensure that folks using the CDN are properly licensed. Now, older versions of the CDN or older versions of our products that are using the CDN will remain unaffected. So if you have an existing application, nothing is going to switch on and all of a sudden break. And these license keys are very easy to provide. We have a documentation article around that, and it's 100% local, so you don't have to worry about it reaching out to anything to do the verification. So it's all done within your application. So that's just a heads up for anybody using the CDN. If you upgrade to R3 2022 and beyond, you will have to provide that. But again, no application will break. Even if you do the upgrade, the build and the actual application won't break. It will just display a warning message for in the developer console that you, of course, would see as a developer. So try to make that as easy as possible. We're just kind of a heads up for anybody using the CDN. We also have taken a look at the Kendo UI Dojo, which for anybody using the jQuery components, when you click edit on the demo, this is what it pops up in. So it's kind of like a JS Bin, JS Fiddle, Stack Blitz, Code Sandbox kind of environment.
Sorry, it was the now with 100% more sass that got me.
Yeah, I know. I like that, right? Like I wanted to say something sassy, but I couldn't think of anything in the moment. But when we wrote the screenshot, like the description for it, I was like, now with 100% more sass, and I thought about that pun. Yeah. So they are using all the examples within the Kendo UI Dojo are now using our SAS themes by default. And as a reminder, I know I've sent emails both actually about the CDN license keys as well as the announcement about the less themes. But just as a reminder, the less space themes will be deprecated with R1 2023. So that will be the last version with support for the less
themes. I don't think you have to worry about it. Nobody's using less anymore. It's totally fine.
There's a lot of people still using less.
Just making sure.
Now, for those of you that are in this situation, we have a lot of documentation around how to do the migration. And also, while we're still actively fleshing some of this out, we do have equivalent swatches available within our existing themes to make that transition a little bit easier. So just as a quick heads up, while we're on the topic of SAS and less, I just wanted to make sure we paused here and highlighted that as well.
Someone from the team was saying this is our last release for less.
Yes.
R3 2022. Okay. Wow. Okay.
But let's jump into some of the demos here. So this is just, you know, our demos in dark mode. Shout out to dark mode. And you can see if you're ever worried, well, what's new and what's updated, we try to make it as easy as possible with these lovely little tags and labels that we have everywhere. So if I jump into the first demo, we have the split button, so nothing too wonky, right? As I mentioned, you have the ability to do a main action or a click on the dropdown to be able to see more available actions. And we have the default, the flat, and the outline of this button. And if we jump into the code real quick, there we go. It just took a little while to load, almost made me look like a liar. It should be very easy. Even if I scroll in here a little bit, right, you can see that the icon is very easy to set up, right? It's just a property. And then all the items for the subsequent actions you can take, as well as what happens on click, can all be defined here just within the jQuery object. So nice and easy to set that up. Now, if we take a look at, I'm just going to keep this zoomed in because we'll end up jumping into some code anyways. So the drop-down button, same kind of idea, just not with a element over on the right-hand side. So we can see what that kind of looks like by interacting here. And if we jump into the source, surprise, surprise, right? Very similar in terms of markup here. And the reason that we separated these out, again, is based on the user experience, just making sure that we isolate that. All right, next on the docket is the signature component. So I'm going to just, instead of trying to write a signature, I am just going to simply...
Boo! I showed you my bad signature. Boo!
Sign it!
You do not want to see my signature because it is just chicken scratch. And then on top of that, I'm doing it with my mouse. So, you know, that's essentially what you
do. The pen tablets.
Oh my gosh. You're so like over the top. You're just so fancy.
Now, in terms of implementing this, very easy, honestly. So if we look at the code, right, actually, we do this on Ready and we just attach, you know, Kendo signature.
My gosh, it makes me miss jQuery. Show us more, Carl.
Yeah, exactly. I love it. One big thing that you can keep in mind is that just like you can import something that's an image, you can also export the signature as an image, which helps with some form integration as well, right? If you want to add it in into a regular form to have the signature in there and to make sure that's been submitted alongside with the rest. So you can reuse the signature, which is important since if you can just do the input, does that really do anything if you can't save it somewhere, right? So that's important to have. All right, if we jump into PivotGrid V2, we can take a look at, we have the configurator.
I actually wanted to ask you about this because you said the other one's still living. So it actually just has the V2 in the docs and that's how you find.
Yep. So if we take a look at this, it's actually listed. So we have PivotGrid and PivotGrid
V2. Oh, okay, cool.
In an attempt to make it a little bit easier. Like I said, we didn't want to completely radically change the pivot grid in one release and then have everybody have to transition over. So we're working on this V2 in order to be able to get the features and functionality where it needs to be. And then after that, we'll go ahead and, you know, once we have full feature compatibility, we'll figure out kind of how we can phase that out and make it easy for everybody to make that transition. But with local data binding, if I pop into the code again, what's nice and easy here, as nice and easy as a pivot grid can be, is that we can provide a data source very similar to how we provided a data source in any of the existing data bound components, right? So we have the data source framework item that helps us out with binding to data. But in this particular case, the data that's coming in is being passed in as revenue, which is actually just coming from this country's revenue.js. So rather than now also have to worry about your OLAP cube and the RESTful API for that and directly hooking into the OLAP data source through our data source framework, you can now just pass in a JSON array, right, with your data and then just define how you want the data to look. So in this particular case, right, we're setting up our schema and our model and what the cube looks like and, you know, some pivot grid specific features here, but it's all done with local data binding. And while I say local data binding, to me, it's also just an alternate way to data bind that isn't relying on OLAP cubes, which makes it a little bit easier to not have to necessarily rewrite some data endpoints that you have. All right, now jumping over to some of the grid features. If I scroll down here, really we have the column menu that I covered, right, where you can configure on a column by column basis, which one should have the column menu displayed. So not too interesting, but this really is what I wanted to show off. So we have a grid that now if I take this discontinued field and drag it up here, we see now that we are grouping by discontinued, but we now just have three fields available to us. So we can, of course, expand and collapse this right
How
now.
How could you discontinue Grandma's Boysenberry Spread? How?
Yeah, I am sorry that I discontinued. Actually, this one is false. It's not discontinued. If we go
it's
the
false.
Other way,
one must be able to read.
Yeah, so Chef Anton's gumbo mix is discontinued.
It's discontinued.
As is Michikobe Niku, which we have 29 units in stock. So hurry and buy that before it runs out completely. So that kind of covers a lot of the features that we added in this release. And then I just wanted to also highlight the WCAG 2.1. Oh, now I clicked on something, so let me go back. Section 508 and WCAG 2.1 compliance, and then those accessibility demos. So to make it a little bit easier, rather than try to provide a bunch of different demo links within our demos, we have created this table, which we've had for a lot of releases, but this gives you an idea of how the level of compliance of each component. So Section 508 compliance, which Section 508 and WCAG aligns now, but still. And then under WCAG 2.1, you get to see is it double A, potentially triple A. And then if you're like, ah, yes, now I want to test this with accessibility in mind, you can click on this demo and that opens up an isolated environment that just has the app bar with a couple of just a very basic look and feel. And yes, okay, this isn't necessarily something that you want to show off as the best user experience on the planet, but that's not the intention of these demos. This is purely to give a link that you can then test and say if it passes or fails your accessibility testing. So this is just an easy and quick way to be able to look at our components. As I mentioned, you don't need to have a developer
that
sets all this up for you. And
that's really cool. Do we have plans to version that out?
Is this just jQuery?
Both of us, like,
tell us where this is.
And I saw the scroll bar pop up a little bit in the question area as well. So yes, right now, this is just for jQuery, but it is something that we have plans for the other products as well.
This just in, jQuery is Carl's favorite.
That's what I take away from this.
You keep on trying to put me on the spot. I love all my children equally. I just happened to cover the jQuery portion.
That's really cool. Like, that's really freaking cool. That's, yeah. I love here.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
So we're really excited about this. As Catherine mentioned, you know, we and Alyssa mentioned as well, actually, as a part of the RTM process of the Pivot Grid, we believe in accessibility. And if we don't have some accessibility baked into the component, it's not officially out. So that's one of the criteria to move from beta into V1. And this just further kind of takes, you know, another step to see, okay, what else can we provide our customers and their teams in terms of resources around accessibility. So this just makes that a little bit easier for folks. If you like this and you want to see it in other products, feel free to let us know. You have the chat, you have #HeyKendoUI, or if you're an existing customer, you can of course submit a support ticket and say, I love that and I want it in framework X. All right, so that kind of takes care of what we have on the jQuery side, and I know you know there's quite a lot to cover there, and that's a lot of fun. But let's and I'm a little bit early, but that's great because now there's a lot on the Vue side as well. So let me jump back into my slides here and cover what's new in Kendo UI for Vue. All right, so to kick things off, we have the Fluent theme that we talked about. We have the Theme Builder Pro, which we've also chatted about. And then we have a ton of new components on the Vue side. So tree list, which is a big component, the badge, all the color pickers that you might ever need. We have some Visual Studio Code productivity tool updates, grid improvements, input updates, and more. What's great about this release is that I can't physically fit all the features on the jQuery side or on the Vue side into the slide deck without keeping you here all day. And as much as I think you enjoy me talking, I don't think you want to listen to me all day. But just like we covered on the jQuery side, the new Fluent theme follows a Microsoft design system that is called Fluent. The new Theme Builder Pro, for those of you that are just joining us on the Vue portion, we have Theme Builder, which you might have used in the past in order to be able to help you quickly style our components to take one of our existing themes and make the colors and the look and feel your own. And we're now expanding upon that. So we've rewritten the Theme Builder kind of from the ground up. So out of the box, the new Theme Builder is twice as fast. It lets you sync your work in the cloud and aligns our SAS variables with the existing SAS themes that we have. And then on top of that, we've now added an additional pro version that has a lot more granular functionality you know, can bring down the customizations to that atomic level. If you missed what is possible with the Theme Builder, I won't be able to cover everything in this section, but in the recording, you can check out first Alyssa jumped in and showed off the Theme Builder a little bit, and then Catherine showed off a really highly customized theme that she put together with the Theme Builder, or I guess you might have had it already imported into the Theme Builder and then tweaked it a little bit further. But we're excited about this for anybody looking to customize the look and feel of the Kendo UI for Vue components. The new Theme Builder is a great tool to use. All right, now the first of the new components that we have on the Vue side is the new native Vue tree list. And you'll hear me use the word native a lot, and that is because when we first started creating components for Vue, we wrapped around our jQuery components just as a way to be able to give everybody out there looking to transition to Vue something while we were working on the native components. And since then, we have rewritten a ton of our components from the ground up, so there's no jQuery code in there for Vue developers. And that's just why you might see some of these components that you might already be taking advantage of, or you might say, oh, you know, I thought that was already available in Vue. And this is just, we're introducing the native version of these components. So the tree list aligns very similar to a data grid, but the main differences, and we can see this in that first name column, is that it deals with hierarchical data, so data you can expand and collapse, but each field, no matter how much you expand, aligns across columns. So it's not another data grid within a row, for example, or a custom row template. So when you expand Daryl, you see Guy. When you expand Guy, you see Buffy. And then, you know, kind of continues on into however long deep you need to go into the hierarchy, but keeping those columns aligned. But you still have filtering, sorting, editing, all that good functionality out of the box. We added the badge component, which outside of being a badge of honor, right? allows you to do a lot of different things. So the badge component seems like a simple component when you first look at it, but then you think about how many things in our life probably uses a badge. So you have the some examples on the right-hand side. You have the busy or available or away notification or status element within a profile picture. You might have notifications and you want to be able to display how many available notifications there are, or maybe you just want to do a little dot and attach that to an element just to indicate that something's new with it, that the user should click on that particular element. And it can be attached to any HTML element, as well as, of course, any existing Kendo UI for view components. The first set of color picking components is the color picker itself. So we see kind of what it looks like over on the right-hand side, but the color picker provides you with a basic element that is a square representing the selected color, as well as a drop-down element. And when a user clicks inside of that, it shows this little interface that we have here, and it can also actually show a predefined list of colors that folks can select from in a palette. So the color picker really is everything I'm about to show, kind of all combined into one, and it hides the overall user experience behind a dropdown. So if it's a part of a form, or you just don't need a lot of real estate taken up by the color selection, then the color picker is a great component to use. Similarly, we have the flat color picker, which is the same idea, but it's not hidden behind a dropdown. So while this looks and feels just a little bit different based on what we saw in the pop-up and the previous screenshot, it's just a different set of configurations where you actually see the element that's currently selected in gray in the top left corner means that we're selecting a color based on a gradient. And then if we click on the other one, that icon will allow us to pick from a pre-selected list of colors, but this is the color picker without having it hidden behind a dropdown. Now the color gradient extracts just that color gradient selection. So if you want to write your own color picker, or if you just want to have this functionality available without the additional hassle, then the color gradient is for you. And similarly, the color palette extracts that palette functionality that I talked about with a predefined list of colors you can select from, and instead allows you to just display these as we see here, a collection of squares that users can select from and pick a particular color. And now on the Kendo UI productivity tools for Visual Studio Code, we've done a couple of different things in the view side. First, we added code snippets. So you might have already been taking advantage of this because we introduced them a little bit earlier, and then we've been slowly but surely adding more code snippets in there. And the idea behind these code snippets is just like you're using Kendo UI for view as a way to gain some productivity in your UI development, you now have the ability to gain some productivity while using our component. So you type in KV dash, and then you get a kind of autocomplete that allows you to select which component that you're dealing with, and it will automatically generate code for all the Kendo UI for view components. And it's even smart enough to know when it's within a subcomponent. Let's say you're trying to work on some columns within the grid. It knows that it's within the grid markup so that it can quickly auto-generate other aspects of grid configuration for you. Now we have a couple of demos that we want to highlight as well on the view side. So one of the big things for view is that we have a live and updating data demo. So we don't see that quite here, but we have a fake dashboard, and I need to make sure that's true so nobody or mention that so people don't rush out and try to buy Bitcoin or Ethereum at historically high levels and not current levels. But that this demo just shows how easy it is to have a data source that's constantly updating and just easily bind that to the Kendo UI for view grid. Honestly, most of the code is about faking a live and streaming data source, and binding it to the data grid is super easy. In a similar fashion, we have a performance demo, which shows off how you can, either through paging or through virtual scrolling, deal with column and row virtualization within the view data grid, and just gives you an idea of just how fast the component is. So rather than us saying, hey, yes, the grid is performant, good luck configuring it, now we actually have a demo that shows kind of the component in its best light from a performance perspective of we just care about scrolling performance. And then, of course, if you want to add some other user experiences, you might want to tweak that a little bit, but this gives you an idea of kind of what you can do to benchmark. I do Definitely recommend that you take this code, download it, run it locally, as opposed to running it within our demo runner, but still gives you a nice and easy project you can copy and paste or open up in StackBlitz or Code Sandbox to modify a little bit further. We've also updated some filtering examples with the grid. So now you have a lot of different filtering examples that you can take advantage of. So different filter user experiences essentially dealing with the grid, including filtering the grid with an external component. It happens to use our filter expression builder component in this particular case, but you can imagine that it can be any set of custom user experiences that you have for filtering data specifically. Another fun example is the sticky rows functionality. And within the data grid now, and you can kind of see that in the GIF, although it's moving a little bit fast, but a sticky row is a row that it can be locked or stuck at the top of the grid as you're scrolling through your data. But what makes it sticky is it is not permanently locked there unless you want to. So a sticky row can either be something that you toggle, for example, with this little magnet icon that we have in the locked column, and then it appears at the top. Or you could also have it where the row will be displayed at the top only when you scroll past it. So it kind of, as you scroll past it, it sticks at the top. And then when you scroll back to its original position, it'll actually unstick itself. So this is why it's not a frozen row or a locked row. It is a sticky row because sticky means it kind of stays there. But if you really need to get away, you can, you know, pull yourself out of something sticky, right? So that's why we call it a sticky row. We also added the ability to have a built-in loading indicator now within the Kendo UI for View Data Grid. And this actually uses our standalone loader component. So that means if you've done any customization to the loader component, or you are familiar with the loader component, or you jump into its demos, you can take full advantage of the customization options there. And this will then display whenever any sort of data operation is done within the data grid, so filtering, sorting, initial binding, whatever it might be, so you can have that loading indicator display. We also did one quick update to our paging within the grid, and that is to have the all option available when you're paging. That actually was missing in previous releases of the data grid and the pager. So now when users select, oh, I want 5, 10, 25, however many items per page, they now have the option to select all, so you display all data items at once. Kind of a small thing on the surface, but still big quality of life improvement for something that was missing in the paging for the View Grid. We also have an example that showcases how you can do dynamic column display. So this is dynamically adding or removing columns from a list of data grid columns. So this isn't just showing or hiding columns depending on user preference. This is legitimately interacting with the underlying column collection and being able to change what columns should be displayed and how. So this demo, you know, pops up quite frequently as a request from our customers. So we just want to make sure that we have a demo available that shows off how you can go about doing that in your applications. So that's it for the data grid. And then on the input side, we added a suffix and prefix support, or adornment, as we like to call it. And what that is essentially a template area before and after the input element within that you're using. So it could be a text box, it can be mass text box, whatever it might be. In this particular case, in this screenshot, you see that we have that little hamburger menu and then the calendar icon. And that is actually a prefix element on top of our text box component. So this can be used either for something like this, just displaying some icons. So maybe that is a little bit more intuitive what that checkbox, or sorry, text box is for. And you, because this is a template, you can actually provide a view template, which means you can now also, for example, if you click on that calendar, maybe you actually have a calendar pop up. So thanks to this now, you can add custom elements before and after input elements while still making it a part of the actual text box or mass text box or whatever other input that you're using. So this gives you that flexibility in case you need some additional elements added for some updated look and feel. And then, as we mentioned, we have accessibility improvements across the board, and that also applies to Vue. We also will have, this is actually a slight, just this will happen in the next couple of weeks. For those that need a VPAT document, so for those not familiar, this is just a standard way that the U.S. government has provided that folks can communicate their level of accessibility compliance back and forth. And this is sometimes just a request that teams have in order to be able to understand the level of accessibility. So the VPAT will be available upon request. Should just be in a couple of weeks or so. But I wanted to mention that here, even though it's not officially out, just because we've done all this work with accessibility and also want to make sure folks are aware that a VPAT document will be there. We also had some interesting compatibility updates where we have support for Vue.2.7. Some of you might be familiar, might say, well, hey, now we're talking about Vue 3. Why isn't that what we're talking about here? Why are we talking about Vue 2? So we have had Vue 3 support since day zero within Kendo UI for Vue. But what's very unique about Kendo UI for Vue is that we support both Vue 2.x and Vue 3.x. So with this update, so the Vue team themselves updated Vue to Vue 2.7. I forget what the next number is, but we have support for that as well as our ongoing support for Vue 3. So depending on where you are in your Vue journey, we got you covered. And then finally, the last update that I have before we jump into some quick demos and we wrap up the webinar is that we do have a dashboard application that is now rewritten completely with our native Vue UI components, as opposed to previously where we kind of had a mix of some wrapped components and the native components. So just gives you an additional example that you can use to kind of get a feel for how our components can be used together. All right, but let's quickly jump over and cover some Vue demos. So let me close this down. So when you navigate to our Vue demos, just like you saw on the jQuery sign, you can see a list of all the new components as well as the ones that have been updated at some point over the last couple months. But if we look at the tree list, we see there's a basic overview functionality that it does operate very similar to a data grid. The exception just is that as I expand and collapse these rows, I'm not opening up another data grid, for example, with the hierarchy that you often see with the parent and child data table. It's all just kind of focused on the hierarchical data while keeping that alignment of columns. And on the left-hand side here, you should be able to see that we do have a lot of different examples of, you know, how do you deal with virtual scrolling, exporting to Excel? What if you want to have flat data, not hierarchical data? What do you do? So we have that available for you. So really a nice amount of functionality just out of the box with V1, which is very impressive. Let me close down some additional demos here. We have the new badge component, which is pretty easy actually to implement. We can, you can see a quick look here at how you can apply it to regular elements and then provide some additional CSS that you might want to work with in order to be able to customize it. You can see how you can alternatively set up a badge container, which then you can use that to kind of align with some more advanced templates, for example, and be able to attach the badge component there. So there's a lot of different things you can do with the badge. Like I said, it sneakily is a very advanced component, even though it's tiny in terms of screen real estate. Then for the color pickers, I won't cover each and every one of them, but you see that we have them available here. So here's the color picker, which, as I mentioned, includes the flat color picker just in a pop-up. And then this screen is the gradient that allows you to provide RGB values or hex values if you like to. And then we can switch over to the palette, select the color, hit apply, and we now see that that's provided there. And the flat color picker, the color palette, and the color gradient just are all kind of separate UX elements of this color picker, depending on what you need within your library. Now, let me There we go, close that out. Some more color pickers. We also see that we have the adornments feature that I talked about, right, of that prefix and suffix support. But in this particular case, we have an input, and then we have an input with adornments. And so that has that little cog there. So I should clarify that. I'm gonna zoom in just a little bit more. So I'd break everything. But what you can see here is that it's nothing too crazy. We have a K input in this particular case. We give it a particular style and we pass in an icon name here. If we want to jump into some more of the built-in adornments as well as, which is kind of what we show there. And then if we want to also then see what it looks like if we want to provide our own custom ones, this documentation article here, prefix and suffix adornments, is where you want to go. So that gives you an idea of how you can use the pre-built or built-in ones. Apologies, as well as the custom templates for prefix and suffix support there. I'm looking at the time and I have a little bit of time, but let's just take a look at the live updating data. And we can see here that I can actually get down to 1 millisecond. Let's do that. And we can see here that we have a lot of strong sells, strong buys. But the idea here, right, is that you can see that this amount of updating is no problem whatsoever to the Kendo UI for View Data Grid. And this demo, of course, is supposed to showcase that, but also give you, the developer, an idea of how easy it is to bind to this data. If we look into the source code, a lot of this, I'll be completely honest, is because we need to write code that emulates hooking into a real endpoint that's updating this quickly. So that's just really where most of the source code comes from there. But let's do, we have just about a minute left, so let me cover some last minute cleaning up here. So everything that we covered today is available at telerik.com/kendo-ui. Absolutely everything for jQuery, Angular, React, and Vue, all covered under this one magic link. Also, Alyssa pointed out that I do blog about what's coming, what's new, and usually every 6 weeks or so, I have a little blog post showing off what we've been working on, and then, of course, we have the R3, R1, and R2 releases. I took them in a weird order, but, you know, the three major releases we have throughout the year, and a ton of additional things on there. We blog about a lot of different stuff. So, with that being said, we are right up on the hour, so quick little progress animation here should bring us to the end of today's webinar. So I want to thank everybody for taking the time with us today. And I see that a lot of you have asked questions, so do appreciate that. Hopefully all of our helpers were able to respond to your questions. Thank you again to everybody that's behind the scenes or helping us out. And some folks that are listing some of the questions I've been looking over just to see some of that that's been highlighted. So thank you. And that just about does it for R3 2022 for Kendo UI. So until next time, everybody, thank you so much, and we will see you in the next webinar.